What is going on, everybody? Today, I am going to be breaking down the four different Imperial Star Destroyers with a little bit more focus on what makes them different from each other. So if you've seen, I've done ship breakdowns in the past. I have done an Imperial Star Destroyer breakdown, but since then we've had Wave 7 has come out and we've got two new types. So we have the Imperial 1, the Imperial 2, the Kuat, and the Simoon. And so I'm going to just talk about these four and what kind of makes them different. They each kind of have a different little corner of the galaxy that they can kind of work in, and I'm going to talk about all of them. Also, before I get too much further, I do want to remind you all there is another round of the giveaway going on. It's a real big giveaway this time. I'm giving away three X-Wing conversion kits in the form of Cool Stuff gift cards. So I'm giving three of those away, and that will be announced before Gen Con. So make sure you are entered to win one of those. I am doing three at a time. I usually do one giveaway at a time, and these are, I usually only do a $20 gift card, and these are going to be about 42 or so for the full conversion kit. I'm doing three of them. So anyway, all it takes is to become a subscriber and leave a comment on this or one of my other videos. It's as simple as that, and then you can enter to win one of those. That being said, let's jump right in. So let's take a look at the Imperial One first. It is, first thing you're going to notice, that this is the cheapest one. So if you're just trying to get a Star Destroyer in your list to save points, this is the way to go. This is the cheapest version you're going to get at only 110 points. As we look at the upgrade bar, one thing that makes this one unique as well is that it has two slots for offensive retrofit, which makes it kind of unique in that regard as well. This was the original Star Destroyer that had black dice because the Imperial II also came out, but that one was all blue and red. So this was originally your up-close and personal Star Destroyer, but it was more dangerous because it didn't have the defensive retrofit. That's one thing it lacks here. And that's kind of an important thing because when this first came out, we didn't have cards like Minister Tua to give it that defensive retrofit. So this one kind of struggled in that regard because it would get up close and personal and it would take a pummeling as well. Granted, with 11 hull, it can potentially survive that. It does have a black and blue for squadron attack, which is good. And it also has three command, four squadron, and four engineering. This one makes a pretty effective carrier because of that. Let's look at the ISD-2. Now, the ISD-2, you're going to notice, has two blue dice. First off, that's one of the big differences you're going to notice right up front. This is where it can attack squadrons with less consistency but longer range. More consistency of attacks, but less hits. Black dice are more likely to get that hit against the squadron, but blue dice are going to be able to go out further and hit more squadrons with a single attack. Also looking at 3 command, 4 squadron, and 4 engineering here, 120 points. So this is the most expensive Imperial Star Destroyer, and perhaps maybe the most well-rounded of all four of them. Now, when in this particular version of Star Destroyer, you do get the defensive retrofit down here, which is nice. However, you're not getting that extra offensive retrofit. But your front arc is a lot of long-range attacks. You got 4 red and 4 blue, which is really nice. You got red and blue on the sides as well. So this thing is made to be able to deal a lot of damage at a lot of ranges, and including up close and personal, but the more important thing is at long range, where that arc is covering the most area on the board. Next up, we have the first of two that came out with Thrawn in the Chimera expansion. We have the Kuat refit. Now, this one is interesting because at a glance, it looks similar to the Imperial Star Destroyer 1 as we go back and forth, because we have blue and black dice there. The dice are actually almost the same, although Kuat does have a blue on the sides, and Kuat also has a black in the rear, which the ISD-1 does not have. That being said, another thing that's kind of funny that's different is the Kuat has a blue and a black for squadron dice, but the Imperial one has a black and a blue. So I don't know why they chose to make those vice versa. There's no actual gameplay difference between it being black-blue or blue-black, but I just thought that was funny, and I wonder if that's a little hint of something that they might reference. Maybe your first listed squadron die, something happens to it at one point that might actually make a point of distinction between these two that we don't already see. However, I doubt that'll happen. It's just kind of speculation on my part. One thing else you'll notice is that you're at 112 points, so this is much cheaper than the Imperial 2, but a little bit more expensive than the Imperial 1. But that gives it a relatively comfortable price point for such a large ship. And another thing that makes this one, you know, very much stand out is this is the first Imperial Star Destroyer to have the ordnance slot, so we can actually make advantage of those black dice and put some really cool ordnance upgrades on this thing that are going to allow it to take advantage of black dice even further. Well, another thing you are going to notice, though, is that this one has a squadron value of only 2, so much less equipped to be a carrier, much more equipped to be a black dice delivery system, so a little bit more singular focused. But to help with that, it does also have the defensive retrofit. And now this comes at the cost of the turbo laser slot, and but again, for a ship like this, perhaps ordnance is much better than turbo laser for some people, and I think that's kind of the preferred method, especially if that's what you want. If you wanted turbo laser, though, you could simply go with Imperial One. If you wanted ordnance, you could go with Imperial Kuat. So there we go for the Kuat. Let's also take a quick look at the Simoon. The Simoon has a number of different things, and this is the one I think that caught the most people's attention because a number of startling things that were different about it. One of the things that I noticed that was most different about this when I first saw it was the 5 red dice in the front, which is very, very nice, especially when you combine that with the double turbo laser, which is really, really something. So that opens up all kinds of doors for us. This is your long-range strike fighter. And one of the things you lose is you do lose the defensive retrofit, but you also get fleet support, which is something that up until this point was only available to the Rebels. So this opens up an entire new category for the Empire, which makes this ship also extremely interesting on so many other levels. Again, at 112, it's cheaper than the Imperial II, which was, from a certain point of view, your long-range ship, you had 4 red dice in the front, but here you've got even more red dice in the front, and it's cheaper. And if you're looking at red dice, you have better upgrades as well. So this seemed like this was a complete upgrade over the Imperial II at first, but if you look closer, you'll realize that it's not necessarily, because it's still more singularly focused. Other changes include the squadron value of only 3 as opposed to 4, like we see on our original Star Destroyers. Which is fine, but it does give you a little bit of a difference there, as well as the double black anti-squadron dice, which some might consider worse because there's no blue range on them, but some might consider better because when squadrons do get close, you're much more likely to roll those hits because the black dice have so many hit symbols on them. All right, so now let's look at some different ways that we might build some of these ships. I will start with the Simoon since I have it up already. So one of the things that I like to put on a ship like this, especially since I have fleet support, this one came with intensify firepower. So I really like to use intensify firepower on a ship like this because I've got all those red dice and I'm really likely to have at least one blank one. And I'm not always going to use Vader. And that's one of the things I think that you have to just realize is, Vader isn't always going to be there. I like to use Vader a lot to have those dice, mitigation, because I'm a big fan of red dice. So I definitely like this ship. But if I'm not going to use Vader, then I have to have some other way to mitigate bad dice. And this is a great way to do it. And it tends to work better if you have a lot of ships. So if you're doing one big ship and a couple of small ships, this is a great card to add in that. But since I want to take advantage of the red dice and kind of having this guy hang back and shoot from afar, one of the things I would definitely want to do is I would like to maximize what he's good at, and that's that front arc. So we're going to say spinal armament, increase that up to 6 red dice, 7 if a concentrate fire command is in the queue. And then we can also give him XI7, which will mean that those dice at long range have to be braced or something, because they're not going to really be able to be redirected very much. I like that option. Now, for the Simoon, there's other things that we can do. I definitely want to make sure I have gunnery team on a ship like this. Gunnery team works best on ships that can shoot farther and farther away. I generally don't like gunnery team on ships that are black dice intensive. just because at range one, you're less likely to have two shots in the exact same arc. But at range three, you're far more likely to have two shots in the same arc because that front arc is big, but at range three, that cone is so wide. You're very, very likely to be able to take advantage of this. And when you do, you're really putting those 7 points to work because in this configuration, you're putting those 7 points to work for six dice on a whole nother ship with intensify firepower, mitigating any bad rolls or partially mitigating bad rolls, and then the XI-7 is there as well. And this isn't too bad. This brings this ship up to 140 points, which is a real, real big threat, especially staying in the back line. You want to kind of roll this ship in kind of slow, so this way it can try to stay out of harm's way. It doesn't have the defensive retrofit. I mean, you could put Minister Tua on there if you really wanted to, but I don't think that's something you need to do because I don't think this is a ship that you want to fly in very fast. I think this is a ship you want to keep in the rear. Next up, let's take the opposite approach. Let's take a look at the Kuat refit and how I might build the Kuat. So here's a ship that I do want to have fly right in. So one of the first things I would do on a Kuat is I would put... Now, you could do a couple of things. You could do early warning system, which is a good option if you wanted to make some, you know, put this on your front. Early warning system is very, very nice on Star Destroyer. But since I will be going so fast, I'll go with electronic countermeasures primarily because of the fact that I need to make sure that that brace can work, and I'm probably going to be getting hit from all angles if I'm going fast enough, especially if I want to jam that front arc at somebody. Now, when this first came out, you know, this was the biggest claim to it right here, is that you could finally put some ordnance upgrades on the ISD, which is great. And there's a ton of different things you can do. I like expanded launchers. This is going to give it a lot more dice. But I think another way to potentially, you know, is use some of these black crit options. For example, we could do assault concussion missiles, and we could also do a fire control team. This way, we're going to have so much damage coming in that perhaps, you know, we're able to get damage through to hull and also do extra damage on the sides with assault concussion missiles, so we could potentially weaken those sides and ensure that the first face damage to hull is also a crit. So there's options like that. We could also consider, because we have the blue crit here, we could potentially put heavy ions in if you were trying to really take advantage of fire control and trigger your blue crit to first to drain those shields and then trigger assault concussions to do damage to those sides that may not have any shields left. And then, and here's the time where you're like, all right, yeah, you can't put XI-7 here, but you probably don't need it because they're not going to have any shields left on the adjacent sides. So this is, just a potentially really nice thing. But this isn't how I think I'm going to do the build for this guy today, just because of the fact that while heavy ions is nice, I've only got a little bit of blue dice. So the chances of me actually getting that blue crit are a little bit more slim here. So... let's go ahead and change up this build a little bit. We'll take off the fire control team. We'll go ahead and change this one out. Since we've only got two blue dice, leading shots is actually a pretty good. Again, like I said, you're not always going to have Vader. And if you do, you probably don't need leading shots. But since you're going to have, since you've got a blue die in every arc, being able to spend that die to reroll any number of dice is great, which means you can save points now. You don't necessarily have to go ordnance experts, for example. A lot of people also, were running Avenger with boarding troopers, boarding troopers. But the problem with doing that here is that this is based on your squadron value, and with Kuat, you only have a squadron value of two. So while this is a candidate for Avenger, I don't think it's necessarily the best candidate for Avenger because of the low squadron value. So a title I should say that I'd like to draw your attention to is one that I'll put expanded launchers back on here, and just a title that's going to take advantage of that front arc. I'm going to suggest taking another look at Devastator, which is one that we haven't really used in a whole lot. But you know, once per round while attacking from your front hull zone, you may add a blue die to your attack pool for each of your discarded defense tokens. So this is going to work here. For one, you've got leading shots already. So even if you're at long range and you're just rolling those three red, if you've already spent something twice, you can, you know, you can still add a blue die in there and maybe spend it to reroll the three blank reds you just rolled, which is a possibility. But Devastator and Expanded Launchers combined, which was never a possibility before, gives you a tremendous opportunity here to be able to roll. Let's count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 with a Concentrate Fire, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. You can potentially roll 15 dice on this ship, and that's without any objective stuff giving you bonus dice. I mean, imagine opening salvo, 17 dice, you know, in one shot is, you know, that's just incredible. And then you'll have rerolls with leading shots. So you spend one of those blues and reroll everything else. That's absolute insanity. And even without Devastator, you're still looking at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 dice with a Concentrate Fire. So, and it'll only get stronger from there. So this guy is going to go down. ECM, I think, works well for this because, you know, if you have already spent your brace once and somebody does attack you again, and you're for one, you're going to be right in the middle of the fighting. You want to be able to spend those tokens, keep yourself alive longer, and then eventually spend multiple tokens, you know, to help keep yourself alive longer, and let Devastator get you some kind of 15 die attack by round six. That would just be that could be absolutely magnificent. You could even consider putting hardened bulkheads on this guy too, since you're not going to be using him as a carrier, so you don't really need the offensive retrofit as a carrier as much. Hardened bulkheads would definitely be an option here, since you're very likely to be bumping into ships flying very fast, trying to get in that front arc black die range. If you don't want that, you can use this as an opportunity to try one of the other boarding parties, like Darth Vader, which might be a fun one. Although I have some reluctance with Darth Vader, and that's only because of the fact that if I have you at close range, I would so much rather just kill you and kill all of the cards on your ship. But I think Darth Vader on the ship could also be used for a nimble ship that does manage to just sneak right past you. And if you do activate and a ship manages to get out of your front arc, well, now you can go ahead and take care of the turbolaser reroute circuits on that CR-90, you know, and then just focus your attacks on somebody else, and maybe that ship's not a threat anymore, you know, or take slicer tools off of that flotilla, or take bomber command center off of that flotilla. Now you can really ignore it if you wanted to, but there's definitely options there for the Kuat. But yeah, I think some people were thinking about using the Kuat with the Avenger, and while that works, I just don't think it's the best option for Avenger. I think Kuat is a great opportunity to bring back Devastator and start using that one again, because I think that's a really, really cool title. I used to use it a lot, haven't used it in a long time. Let's jump up to the original two. Let's take a look at the Imperial 2. The Imperial 2 is one I don't think is going to be so popular with people right now, just because they've got two brand new options. And with the Imperial 2, you know, you're going to be paying 8 points more than one of the new Thrawn version Star Destroyers. So you're like, well, do I really want to pay, you know, 120 points for four red dice in the front when I could just go Simoon? Well, I'll tell you why you might want to do that. I think the biggest reason for the Imperial 2 is going to be because it's so versatile. So one of the things that my favorite cards from Wave 7, for example, is heavy ion emplacements. So any ship that has the ion cannon is going to be really nice. That's obviously going to work here. I'll give that heavy ion emplacements. I can do whatever I want here. I could go XI7, but I don't recommend going XI7 and heavy ions. So if you have something to mitigate your dice, you know, you've got somebody giving you, you know, rerolls or something like that, you can do heavy ions and spinal armament. If you don't, then I would suggest potentially going leading shots and XI7. Similar kind of output there. This one might be more effective in more builds, so I'm going to leave this one on here for right now. This gives you still four, potentially five dice at long range. This also stops, you know, effectively minimizes the redirect in the same kind of a fashion that the heavy ion emplacements do, but doesn't require Vader or anything, you know, or having another intensify firepower or something like that in the build. So this is, again, more self-sufficient, more well-rounded. That said, this is one of those guys that also has squadron value of 4, so it makes for a good carrier as well. But if you're flying a gunship, a lot of times an ISD needs to be doing nav commands. I like concentrate fire commands. If it's taking damage, it's going to need engineering commands. You know, a lot of times you don't want to, you know, do squadron commands with an Imperial 2, just because you have so many more important things you need to do. And that is why Thrawn actually makes this ship great. So if you are running Thrawn as your commander, I think this is a fantastic ship to add to your fleet, because he is such a good gunship. One of the best, maybe one of the best ships in the game at long range. Maybe the best ship in the game at medium range. And for that same stake, we're going to put gunnery team on here. But also one of the better carriers in the game, with that squadron value of 4. So why don't we go ahead and also upgrade it to be a great carrier as well, and you will get, you know, if Thrawn has a couple of squadron commands on him, you can have this guy worry more about doing things that, doing nav. Or you could do it the other way around. Have, if this is your main carrier, maybe you're only running like four or five squadrons, and you want this guy to be able to activate them. Maybe you just have this guy dial up the squadron commands, and you have Thrawn give out the other commands like nav that might be more universal to your build. It really depends on what you're trying to do. If you're running like an Imperial 2 and a couple of Gazantes as carriers and a really heavy squadron build, then I would have Thrawn be the one to give out the squadron commands. This way nobody can mess with your dial. It's usually safer to have Thrawn pocket those squadron commands when you really need them. It just depends what's most important to your build. If nav is going to be most important because you only have a moderate squadron presence, then put nav on Thrawn. If you're going with a very important, a very heavy squadron presence, put that on Thrawn. But because of the versatility here, I think this one makes for an excellent carrier. Now in this case, this is one where maybe we'll put early warning system in. Early warning system is going to be great for this guy as he's getting closer, because this one, while he does want to hang in the back a little bit, he doesn't want to stay in the back. He wants to get up a little bit closer than the Simoon does, because he also wants to take advantage of all those blue dice as well. And that brings me up to another point is, you know, you don't always have to do leading shots as well. You could also consider, something like SW7s, which is, again, it's 1 point more. But this also gives you some help. You don't have to spend a die this way. And if you get a whole bunch of extra accuracies, this is going to guarantee you get a minimum, into range 4. I'm sorry, not range 4, but into close range, and you'll have 4 damage guaranteed, because those blue dice have to come up as either an accuracy, a hit, or a crit. So it's good when you have to absolutely guarantee that you get a certain number of damage. Those are another option, but I'll set them back to leading shots for the time being, just because I think this one helps us a little bit more at two different ranges, but it depends on how you want to fly it in here. Early warning system is a real nice option for the Star Destroyers, especially if you're combining them with 7th Fleet. The 7th Fleet is a really nice, I ran this recently, where you could make sure that all those attacks that are coming to your front as you charge forward into battle, early warning system is going to reduce one of those dice coming at you for every attack, because if it's coming to your front, it's going to be obstructed. And then 7th Fleet is also going to cut another damage down. So all those red dice attacks, somebody starts off even, with an Architans or an Assault Frigate or a CR-90 at long range, or even an Imperial 2 rolling 4 red dice, one of them goes away. So they're down to 3 off the bat. One of those damage gets reduced, so they're down to probably 1 to 2 damage on average coming through to you, whereas it could have been 4 or more. So these just help keep you alive as you're moving into the fight. Imperial Star Destroyer 2, it's versatile. It can stay alive. It's got defensive retrofit. It's got the squadron stuff. For weapons team, you don't need gunnery team on here either. That's useful, and it's a lot of times it's the best. But if you're going more carrier centric, there are other really good options for this slot. I've talked about Ruthless Strategists in some other videos. Ruthless Strategist is insane if you have TIE Fighters, which are probably going to get one-shotted anyway. So you're doing, you're rolling your 2 blue dice at everybody. Oh, I didn't kill you with that one? Take 1 more damage, and I'll just, this TIE Fighter only has 2 damage on, or only has 2 health left. I'll put one more on there. He's still alive, but I guarantee I killed your intel ship or something like that. Ruthless Strategist is just so good. But also as flight controllers. Flight controllers is an amazing option for a big carrier. Flight controllers here, you're activating four squadrons. This is giving you four extra blue dice, or maybe five if you have a token. It's just amazing. And you combine that with expanded hangar bay, which I think is now more useful than ever since Relay has been nerfed. Not expanded hangar bay. I got the wrong one on there. I apologize. But expanded hangar bay is another option. But boosted comms. I think boosted comms might be a better option here. But either one is going to be good, and it depends how many squadrons you have, how many you really need to activate. If you have exactly five squadrons, maybe you do go with expanded hangar bay and make sure you can hit all those three by just having this one guy issue the commands. But if you have a lot more squadrons and more ships doing it, you want to make sure that you have at least one ship that can hit those longer ranges as those squadrons jump out farther ahead. Now let's take a look at the Imperial One, our final Star Destroyer of this evening, and I'm going to actually build this one up as Avenger. Even though we have, you know, we've got our Kuat, I still think this one makes the best Avenger, and a lot of the reason for that is because, let me scroll up, there we go. It is just because it has, that squadron value of four, so you're guaranteeing, even on those bigger ships, that you can shut down their defense tokens. Now, Avenger has been nerfed. So Avenger is going to, it's not going to work for both shots. If you happen to maybe have, a double arc on somebody, you're going to have to exhaust Avenger to use its ability. But that is fine. That's no problem at all. The Imperial One is one of the better carrier ships as well. For one, it's cheap. So, a cheaper a ship is, the more it's going to give you the ability to be a carrier. But, you also have two offensive retrofits here. So you can do expanded hangar bay and boosted comms, which is always a great thing. But there's a ton of options you can do with having two of those. You can use some of the more seldomly used cards, like Phylon tractor beams. Like, I don't ever see people use these anymore. And it actually could be a really helpful card to use, especially with Imperial Star Destroyers, where you are going to have little ships trying to fly out of your front arc. So that's always an option. Rapid launch bays, this is one of those ships that can take rapid launch bays and expanded hangar bay and then deploy five squadrons. So you can do all kinds of really cool stuff like that. But that being said, one of the ways I would build this is I would consider, obviously putting boarding troopers on here. Well, boarding troopers is going to take up some of those. So now I can't go super crazy squadron heavy, but maybe if I wanted, build this one as an Avenger, I will put down hardened bulkheads since I am more likely to ram with something like this. I'm going to be flying fast. I'm going to be going right in and trying to activate and blow up their flagship before they can get me. So that being said, I may or may not have Vader, so one of the things I might want to do here is I might want to consider SW7s on this guy. SW7s as an option, but I think that or leading shots, both options. Leading shots is probably the one I'm more comfortable with, but SW7s does, again, for that front shot, it gives you a little bit. But now the problem with leading shots is that we don't have a blue die on our sides, but there's a way we can get that now, and that's with quad battery turrets. If we start off going fast and we're able to slow down in time, by the time we get close to where we need to be, to the middle of the battle, then we can really make use of quad battery turrets. And one of the ways that I recommend doing this is to try to use this little fella from Star Wars Rebels here, the Grand Inquisitor. Grand Inquisitor is one of those guys who is going to let you be able to change your speed and slow down even when it's not your turn. So, and don't forget, like when you're activating, you're going to shoot before you can move. So if you're at speed 2, for example, like you started to slow down and somebody else is, I'll be able to, I'm going to try to get past your arc or whatever, and they, speed up from 1 to 2 to match you, now you can all of a sudden slow down to speed 1. And now when you're attacking them out of their side because they just got out of your front arc, you still get the blue die from quad battery turrets, and now you can reroll all those dice because you can spend that blue die from quad battery turrets on leading shots. So that's the kind of that combination there. This kind of helps your sides still be effective and get those rerolls. Again, having Darth Vader means you don't necessarily need a lot of these rerolls, and that's one of the reasons why I just love Vader, because he's just universally awesome. But that being said, you know, this is one option you can do for something like that. Another option for a ship like this is to consider price. If you have a strong initiative bid, consider putting Governor Price on a ship like this to make sure, you know, and if you're going fast enough, and if a setup looks like you're going to be in range and shooting range and close range as early as turn two or turn, you know, then select turn two maybe with Governor Price. Start off at speed three, probably not going to die at the end of turn one. You know, it's very rare for any shots to be fired at turn one. Usually it requires some type of special objective that has a strange deployment. That being said, when your opponent, like if your opponents all deploy at speed one, then maybe you don't choose turn two. But if they deploy at speed three or something like that, just set maybe turn two for Governor Price. Bust out at speed three, start charging in for them. And then when turn two comes around, you get to go last. If you do another speed three after your opponent's already going fast, you're going to probably be in range one of them, depending on how you deployed. But it's very reasonable to say that you could be within Black Dice range of them. And so you activate last, and then you go first on turn three, maybe kill their flagship if you're fortunate enough to do that, and then basically shake hands because the game is probably over at that point. So that's one option that you have, but that takes a lot of luck, and a skilled opponent might see something like that coming and will probably stockpile a nav token first turn and plan some nav commands so that if they think you're going to do that, and if you choose turn two with Governor Price, they'll be able to slow down really quick and in a hurry, maybe even slow down to speed zero just to make sure that you don't get in range of them and waste your Governor Price and then kind of spoil your hand. So, you know, granted though, if they do go to speed zero, that also kind of negates the whole purpose of the Avenger title. So those are some options, but and the other thing for any of these ships, especially for maybe the Imperial II, strategic advisor. You know, your large ships can take strategic advisor, and strategic advisor is just amazing on any of these. There's certain ones that need it less. I think the Imperial II is a good option for strategic advisor, though, because specifically, and maybe the Kuat as well. Either one could work really well for strategic advisor, just because he has to be on a large ship, and there's certain ships that really have some, a lot of competition for that officer slot. For example, the ISD one is very likely to want either a Price if it's Avenger, or maybe even a Minister Tua if it really wants to gain that defensive retrofit. But the Imperial II, being so well-rounded, doesn't need anything in particular for the officer slot. So it has a lot of options there. So strategic advisor, just it fits very, very well there. So that's kind of like a quick rundown between all of them. I mean, there's definitely more roles that they can fill. I didn't go, you know, and I'm not talking about all the different titles, because a lot of those are going to depend on things that are outside of the ship card themselves. But I did, you know, hopefully you got a little bit of at least my insight into like what makes these all unique and their strengths and weaknesses. I think if I had to pick my favorite right now, I would still go with the Simoon. Mostly because I like to stay far away. I like to stay in safety. I'm a little chicken. I don't want to get up close to you. I want to stay in safety, and I want to have a lot of red dice. I have had a lot of success with red dice, especially when using Vader, since he's my favorite commander. So this Simoon fits best for me and my playstyle. But I think there's something in here for everybody. So I hope you guys really liked this video. If you did, go ahead and give it a thumbs up. Let me know what you think in the comments below. Don't forget to enter the giveaway. Hit that little subscribe button. There should be a little bell next to that. You can click that for alerts so you get notified when new content comes out. I want to thank you guys so much for watching, and have a great day.